but we're not going to be able to stay too long with these lions this morning. It's obviously going to be a very popular sighting, and it is on one of the boundaries. So I must tell you, we did find them this morning. How lucky are we? Because all their tracks were actually washed away. I had no idea that they were going to be in this area. This is just pure luck. And what a welcoming after the wonderful rains that we had last night, everybody. I know there were a few of you that were watching the dam cam last night, and thanks for all the comments. We are just as excited as you, and I cannot believe that the rain dance that I did last night actually worked. Isn't that amazing? So look at these guys over here. Munching away. They've eaten quite a bit of this buffalo. And for those of you who have just tuned in and maybe missed this, this is the Nkahuma Pride. We are situated at the moment on Juma Private Game Reserve in the Sabi Sands of South Africa. And it is freezing this morning. It's a real chilly winter's day. We've actually got two Birminghams here. The other one is quite hard to see. They're all scattered out in this area. And unfortunately, like I just said earlier, they are not on our traverse anymore. So we're taking a little bit of a long distance view. However, it's a good way to start the show by being able to see lions. I just absolutely love that contrast of the bright red and the lovely colors of the leaves on the ground, as well as that tawny color of one of the Birminghams. Isn't this amazing? So remember, if you'd like to get hold of us or send in any comments, you're welcome to either hashtag safarilife, or you can email us at questions@wildearth.tv. Now have a look at those two little cubs on the bottom right-hand side of your screen. Look how dirty they are. They are filthy. So they've obviously been in the stomach cavity of this buffalo. I can't tell you if it was a male or a female buffalo because the head is on the other side, and they've sort of turned this carcass around now. I think they're going to devour this within a day, maybe a day and a half, but hopefully the rest of the Birminghams get wind of this and they can come and join. But isn't this wonderful? That is a beautiful shot. Like I said, those contrasts of those colors there are so dramatic. It's almost like the photos in black and white already. Wow, munching away. So the rest of the females have already laid down. I think they've eaten their full. So thankfully we've just got a few of them munching. Oh wow, look at the blood around that cub's face. Oh my goodness. They're going to have to do a lot of cleaning up today. I think they're going to need mom's help to restore their normal color. And it is freezing this morning. I can't tell you how cold it is. That drop of temperature from yesterday's lovely warm day to this morning is ridiculous. This is what it feels like in the Eastern Cape on a winter's day. Not what it should feel like in the low veld. Look at that, beautiful. So I'm envious of all of you that are tucked away watching in your nice warm beds. But I'm also not jealous in the same breath. I get to sit and watch this. Oh wow. There you go, it's another little one saying I'm ready to eat some more. Come on. And they've got to be careful not to get too close to that male. We were chatting about it yesterday, but the males don't have too much of a tolerance for the young cubs. And especially when there is a kill around. You could see he was quite happy with them feeding next to him, but they better not get too close. No, that one doesn't want to eat anymore. It actually looks like it just wants to play. These Nkahuma females are just incredible. So Mauritia says that the rain didn't stop the Nkahumas from hunting, and that's correct. I was just about to say, sorry before I didn't finish my sentence, is that these females are the most incredible hunters that I've seen. Every time they go out to try and hunt something, they may miss a few times, but they are so persistent, they do not give up. They carry on until they catch something. So I wonder what time they managed to bring down this buffalo. Really, really great that we came around this way. And you know what actually happened? I must let you in on a little secret. I took a wrong turn. I wasn't looking at my map and ended up around this way. So it was by pure luck that I stumbled across these lions. How great is that? So thank you to the bush. You were very, very kind to me this morning. And you know what's so exciting as well, everybody, is in about 4 days, 4 or 5 days time, there's going to be a lovely layer of green on the ground. And all the herbivores are going to be so happy. Everyone's going to get an opportunity to get some lovely, fresh, new grass shoots, which are going to be packed full of nutrients. All the dams are starting to fill up. They haven't got too much water in. They've got a little bit. I think we probably had anywhere between 30 and 40 mils of rain. I haven't had an opportunity yet to check the rain gauge. Some areas have had 50 mils, some areas have had 40 mils, but I can tell you, it is enough to put a good layer of grass down on the ground in the next few days. I hope you're all taking lots of screenshots of this. It's not often we get to see such an incredible scene. Really stunning. And it's nice and cool. Rightio, everybody. What we're going to do is we're going to hang around with these lions for just a little bit longer. We're going to send you over to Jamie, who I know is itching to say hello to you this morning.
Positively itching, because I am just dying to share my good mood with all of you. A very good morning on our cold, cloudy, windy sunrise safari. It rained! My name is Jamie and I have Dave on camera with me, and before we go any further, I would like you to all join me in a rendition of Happy Birthday. So happy birthday to you, happy birthday to... My name is Jamie and I have Dave on camera with me, and before we go any further, I would like you to all join me in a rendition of Happy Birthday. So happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear David, happy birthday to you. Yay. Happy birthday, Dave.
Thanks,
hip hip hooray! And it rained, and Dave wins the rain competition. We had 17 here. Buffleshook had 40 on their side, which means somewhere on Juma there was an average of 20 mils last night, which means Dave wins the rain competition and he wins the title of weatherman.
Yeah.
Downpour Dave. Yes, he does. An absolutely marvelous start to the morning. Fell asleep with the sound of the rain pouring down on the roofs, and then the thunder and lightning. Luckily, I've got my poncho, which fortunately comes in one size fits all, which means it accommodates my massive bulky frame. Then we're going to head out and see what we can find. I'm going to do a tour of the various dams just to see whether or not there's any kind of a difference. There you go. Wilding, Wyoming says happy birthday Downpour Dave. Yes indeed. I'm going to send you back across to Taylor. I can't really move much. I'm going to go sail away down the roads, and while I do, let's head back to Taylor and her lucky lions.
Look at how that little cub has just jumped onto the top of the carcass and found a nice little part to chew on. Look, he blends in with the color of the buffalo. She can't tell one from the other. They are so filthy, these little cubs. And that's the perks of being so small, is you're able to get right into little crevices that possibly the larger lions aren't normally able to get into. This is always my favorite part. Ooh. Sorry, I'm just looking. One of the other Birminghams is getting up. And I'm wondering if he's going to possibly go over to the kill mount. No, he's sitting down. His face is looking very swollen. I think this is the male that we had yesterday that was with the Nkahumas. Just on his side of his face. Now he's going to sit the other way. You can see even he is cold. So on the side of his face, he had it looked like he'd had a paw to the face, unfortunately. Let's have a look there. You can see the slight swelling. And it does look like it could be a little bit infected. But never fear, everybody. Lions are resilient creatures and he will be fine. It does just look like a superficial wound. But even the other Birmingham, I noticed when he had his head up at one point, they've all seemed to have really big snouts, if that makes any sense. They're quite sort of robust. They're in strange looking lions. I've never seen lions that look like them. You see that? Almost looks like they've all been stung by bees. And we've got lots of other vehicles arriving. So we're not going to stay here for too much longer, I'm afraid. We'll probably stay for another 5 minutes or so. And then we are going to have to, unfortunately, leave these lovely lions. But I don't think they're going to be here for too long. They have devastated this carcass already. Look at that. It's like he's wearing lovely lipstick. All that bright red on his face. Oh, wow. There we go. He's got a nice chunk of flesh. Good morning, Dory. I hope you are well today. Dory wants to know if this is the buffalo that was injured by the Nkuhumas a few days ago. Now, Dory, I am actually not sure. I spent quite a few hours looking for that buffalo, and he disappeared about two afternoons ago. And myself and Jamie were driving the area checking the drainage lines, and we couldn't see him, where he's gone. We didn't see any vulture activity. We didn't really see too much hyena activity. And they would have been on a buffalo kill for many, many days if the hyenas had found that male. So maybe it is. However, it could also just be another buffalo. Like I said, I can't see if it's a male or a female. The head is on the other side, and it's also underneath the body. They sort of twisted this buffalo around quite a bit. So we're just able to get this little view through all the branches. Hello, have a lovely day. Just greeting all the wonderful guests who have come to visit us here in the Sabi Sands of South Africa. This, in my opinion, is the best area for any kind of game viewing, especially the big cats. Lots of lions, lots of leopards. I mean, as you can see, how's this? It's almost like every third day or so we're seeing lions on a buffalo kill. How fantastic is that? Wow. I'm gonna even try and get one little snap because that's too beautiful to pass that scene up. So I hope you are all doing the same thing back at home by taking some screenshots. Really, really nice. And you saw that other Birmingham boy too, how when he stood up, how he curled his body underneath his tail, his head underneath his paws. Wasn't that amazing? Right, everybody, we're going to have to say goodbye to the lovely lions and just give the other vehicles an opportunity to come and see this amazing sight. But hopefully we'll be able to come back a little bit later once everybody has pushed through the sighting. I think Jamie's got another cat for you. See you later.
Look at this. Look who's just come stalking out of the clouds. A lioness with a mouth full of blood on her way back to the rest of them. Where has she come from? Hello, girl. She just came out of nowhere, calling and roaring. Awesome. Absolutely amazing. How was that? All of a sudden, the Impala were alarm calling. Let's reposition. Okay, and let me try and navigate with this massive poncho on. What an exciting way to start the morning. We're going to have to leave her because she's going straight to that sighting, which is already established. And when you are with a moving sighting and there's a static sighting, it's the people with the moving sighting move out. Oh, this is awesome. How is that for an image? Coming soaking wet out of the clouds. Ah, beautiful. Let's catch up with her. Trying to call it in, but I need a chance to chat. I'm actually going to get ahead of her. I'll reverse. Stations 1 with Fuzzy and Gala. Philemon's cut line, but she's highly mobile. She's going back towards that kill. This is where we leave her. Oh, she's calling. and gentle roars, I wonder what separated her from the rest of the pride. Doesn't seem likely that she went for a drink. Because if she had, she would just have gone to one of the nearby puddles. Our mystery lioness. Let's try and catch up with her. We've still got a little bit of space before we have to pull out. Poncho driving. How many lionesses did Taylor have? That's interesting.
Can you hear her calling?
She's calling. This is awesome. There's a second kill. Because it does sound as though the Nkumas have become separated. Okay, so Taylor had four lionesses. This must be the fifth. Standing by, Mike. And I will give you an answer to Sandy's question. Are you welcome to, Mike? Sandy, you wanted to know when a lioness walks past our vehicle, or a lion walks right past our vehicle. Sorry, she's still calling. Does it give us chills when they walk right by us and look into our eyes? Yes, absolutely it does. Not so much chills anymore. Obviously we get very used to it. But there is that, always that feeling when a lioness stops and stares at you. You're nearly there, girl. You're nearly there. When you really look into a lion's eyes, there is a very primitive part of you that responds. There's a part of us that was once upon a time on a lion's menu. In fact, we still are to an extent. Oh, that's beautiful. Just making the most of the sounds that we're hearing. We'll chat a bit more about that in a moment. It's very difficult at the moment for you to hear it because of the wind. The wind is gusting terribly. I'm going to move, so I'm going to turn on my vehicle now. Let's just see if we can't stick with her until she gets... I think we're going to lose her here. Obviously, we can't stay with her once she reaches the kill. Just want to see which way she's going to go. Oh, she's very much on the move. Okay, that might have been our last glimpse of her. I'm going to try for one more. There's no point following her. We know exactly where she's going. She's going to... Perfect hunting opportunity, perfect hunting weather. And the lions have proved themselves once again. Very atmospheric. She's going to pop out on Zoe's, I think. The direction she's going in. Oh, sorry, Dave. That was my fault, not Dave's fault. If, unfortunately, we do know that we're very soft. If I take my microphone out of my hat, it loses its mind in this wind. It goes completely bonkers. So I'm sorry, I know we're very, very soft, but at the moment there's not too much we can do. I hope she's going to pop out on Zoe's. No, stay. Let's see if there's a gap we can spot her through. There she is. Okay, this will be our last glimpse of her as she makes her way back towards that kill. Impala are shouting their alarm at her. There she goes. All right. What a nice way to start off the morning. Haven't we been incredibly lucky? I'm going to go back to Sandy's question in a moment because it's a good one. It's a very important one. There is that moment of connection that we have with lions when they look at us. I'm going to go the other way. The kill's here. We're not far from where Taylor was at all. There she goes. Oh, sorry. That was a bad call on my part. She just disappeared. Oh, there she is. Off she goes. Cheers, guys. Morning. How's it, Mike? Okay. Sorry. That's the end of that. Yeah. I have no doubt. Okay. All right. I'm gonna head off. We'll see you later. Cheers, guys. Ooh, let me not... Okay, so back to Sandy's question, which I don't think I answered properly, and I don't think I answered very well. When a lion looks at you in the eyes, there's a moment, there's the briefest moment when they look at you, and it's, especially at night, there's this connection that we have with them. As the only other social apex predator, we've been in competition with lions for hundreds of thousands of years, for a very, very long time. And there is an emotional connection when they look at you. I don't know how to describe it. Yes, sometimes it's chills. It does raise your heart rate. And I mean, we've had the lions walk right up to us and look at you. I'm sorry, I've never bought into this whole idea of the car being a unit and they don't know you're there. Nonsense. Especially not if you have a child in the back of the vehicle. If the child starts to squeal or squawk or whatever it is that children do, you want to make sure that you've got a very safe distance between you and the animal and that the child is very well behaved. Because that, for a lion, is a distress call. And I think, I mean, Dave, what do you feel when a lion looks at you? Yeah, it is. It's automatic heart rate up. And it's not, for us, it's not necessarily fear because we do it a lot. I mean, at the moment, we're seeing them every single day. But there is, yeah, there is an intensity to it. No other animal looks at you like a lion looks at you. Leopards don't look at you like that, but lions do. And it's different for each and every animal. And I found it's different with male and female lions as well. I don't know if you feel that, Dave. There's an intensity to a female's look that isn't quite there with the male's. And I don't quite know what that is. I don't know if it's the females with slightly more opportunistic nature. more hungry mouths to feed. I don't know what it is, but there is a difference. Alrighty, who's excited for a dam trip? A dam journey. Let's go check Treehouse and Twin Dams and Buffalo's Hook, see how much rain and whether we've had any, see any kind of difference yet. Of course, we're not going to see any greenery just yet, 4 days or so, and the green grasses are going to start poking up and the leaves are going to start going green. That's so exciting. The other thing I'm terrified of, but I'm going to try not to let it impact me, is that we're going to have early rains and then dry December, which I'm really hoping is not the case. Righty, while we head off to Treehouse Dam to do a dam tour, let's go back over to Taylor, who is attempting to navigate.
I'm definitely still trying to navigate Juma Private Game Reserve, but I'm getting better, and you can see my hands are now covered with Eggsy's wonderful gloves. Thank you, Eggsy, because they were held onto the steering wheel and I couldn't get them off. They were frozen. So I did see some very nice elephant tracks earlier this morning. We're going to go back to where I saw them and hopefully we'll be able to pick up. It looked like quite a big herd of elephants. A little bit further west of where we are, so I've got to do 2 turns left, if I'm not mistaken. We will see. I might have to just pick up my phone again and just check where exactly I am on Juma. I'm trying to remember as we go. Woo! Okay, a little bit bumpy. It's quite nice though. A lot of these roads have got quite a bit of sand on them, so the water has drained quite nicely, which is good. Obviously, there are now also some roads that we can't drive after we've had a certain amount of rain. Also, we'll try not to do too much off-roading today. It's never nice to just go and off-road for anything after the rain, otherwise you're going to leave big ruts on the road. Oh, we've got some, looks like some Natal spur files in the middle of the road. Let's see if we can get a shot of them. Go stealth mode. Don't run away, we just want to have a look at you. No? No. I don't know if they want to be seen. You can see them just disappearing in the distance. So those are Natal spur files. And they can be quite easily confused by the Swainson's spur file. But if you look very carefully at their eyes and their beak, if they were to stand still. Now the Swainson's has got a red patch that comes around over the beak and sort of that front section of the face towards their eye. I find that's the easiest way, whereas the Natal spur file tends to lack that. You can see they weren't too impressed with the rain. They're trying to dry their feathers off. It must be quite chilly for them as well, but they will be happy because there's going to be lots of insects around. And I have a feeling that we're going to have an explosion of termites, of the alates, so the princes and the princesses of the termite mounds, and that's going to be exciting. Hopefully that happens in the next couple of days. So normally termites will release sort of the princes and princesses just after rain. The ground is then nice and soft, so they can also burrow down and start producing their own mounds, which is quite exciting. And with all of those insects, with all of those termites, remember I've been saying how high in protein termites are? You're going to get things like African civets, you're going to get genets, you're going to get all sorts of animals. And my favorite, the bushveld rain frog, coming out to munch on all these delicious treats. But we're going to carry on up ahead. We are still making our way to where I saw those elephant tracks. Ooh. Good morning, I Dream of Africa. What a stunning name you have. I Dream of Africa wants to know, with this amount of rain, will it bring any grass? And yes, it will. It's going to take a few days. Unfortunately, it's not instantaneous. But I reckon between 4 and 5 days' time, we will see some nice green shoots coming through the grass. And like I was saying, you're going to even start seeing the browsers coming out and feeding on those luscious shoots. They're going to be so high in nutrients that very few animals are going to be able to pass that up. Well, unless you're a carnivore, then you're probably not going to want to eat the grass shoots. Right, I think I'm supposed to be going this way. We'll drive on it for a little bit and just see where it takes us. And I hope you all enjoyed those lions this morning as well. That was very special. I know, very short and sweet. And it was just amazing just to be able to come around the corner and find something like that within the first 10 minutes of drive. That's what's so exciting, is that every day you go out knowing that you don't know what you're going to see. And I'm particularly excited for all the insects that are going to come out now, and the frogs, because there's quite a few different species of insects and as well as the amphibious creatures that I haven't seen before. So I'm going to have my notebook handy so that I can start growing my list. Right, everybody, while I try and navigate Juma, I think Jamie's got the largest land mammal for you.
I do indeed, although it is amazing how the largest land mammal can disappear into thick vegetation, and our eddies on this windy morning are disappearing off into it. I wonder if they're feeling particularly happy after a night of rain. Probably find that they are a little bit disturbed on a night like last night, with lots of thunder and lightning and plenty of rain. I think with all of the wind, it probably upsets them a little bit. And I have to wonder whether they know, they must know, that rain means good things for them. Surely they must. They must know that they're going to be able to have a change in diet, something better, greener, more nutritious to eat. And of course, water that isn't pumped from the dams and full of muddy hippo excrement. I'm sure they must know that. Is that all waxy buildup in her eye, or is she blind? That's interesting. Unfortunately, we can't get any closer to them, but I can't work that out. Does it look like she's blind in her right eye? It did look like that, didn't it? No, I haven't seen that. I haven't seen that many times in my life. A blind elephant, or at least with one eye with a cataract in it, because that's definitely what it looked like. It didn't look like the normal waxy buildup that you get in the corner of an elephant's eye. Interesting. Ooh, brr. It's quite a cutting wind this morning. Very happily munching away. Okay, we're going to try and reposition to get a different view of these ellies. Obviously they're in some very dense vegetation, so it's difficult for us to see them. But a nice view for now, but I will try in a moment. I'm hoping they might be heading towards Treehouse Dam, although they're not going to be terribly thirsty right now. They're getting plenty of water off the plants that they're feeding on. There are lots and lots of puddles around. That female's a nice example of an old elephant. She's not big. It just goes to show that you can't always judge an elephant by its size. But she does have a very sunken temporal region. In other words, if you look there, the skin around the top of the eye, between the eye and the ear, has started to lose its elasticity and its subcutaneous fat, and starting to sink in around her forehead. And a little bit of bone loss as well. That's a very good way of aging. It's not 100% accurate, but it is a good way of aging an elephant. And it does give you a little bit of an idea that despite her relatively small size, that's actually quite an old female. The fork-tailed drongos fluttering about as well. If you're sharp-eyed, you might see them. They're also going to be rejoicing after all of the rain. Insects coming out, fluttering about. That's not a fork-tailed drongo, is it? Am I imagining? Oh no, that's just a white piece of branch. I thought for a second I had mistaken a southern black tit for a fork-tailed drongo, but I hadn't. We're okay. All good. Let's try. There is a road that runs. There's still a road that runs a little bit further to the south. I'm chuckling because Rebecca just said, "You still got it, Jamie. It's okay. You still got it." Thanks, Bex. It would be a little bit sad if I got a fork-tailed drongo wrong. A bird that we see all the time. All right, let's try go around. Gives us a chance to see Treehouse Dam. Sure, look at all the groundwater. Isn't it amazing? All these puddles. Pinchy Wine is going to be happy. Pinchy Wine is the crab that lives on Zoe's road. All of the animals are going to be happy. Might mean for us that sightings get a little bit more tricky. It does mean that our sightings might get a little bit more tricky, since the animals don't have to all gather around the dams anymore. They can just stop and drink wherever they want to. Stop and have a jolly good wallow, perhaps, in these pans. This isn't quite a pan. I wouldn't go so far as to describe it as a pan. It's a wallow. A puddle. A very big puddle. Now Michael, I think, is asking a question that's on everybody's mind. Although we are so thrilled with the amount of rain that we've had, Michael would like to know, does this mean that it is, there will be more on its way, and is it enough to end the drought? What we need is this was perfect, this rain was perfect. It was a lot of rain, but it was nicely spread out throughout the evening, not a massive downpour that then washed away all of the topsoil, because of course the topsoil has got no grass to hold it in place. But what we kind of need, to be honest, to really make a difference to water supplies and to groundwater supplies is this for 2 weeks. 2 weeks solid, just constant on and off. Not quite drizzle, just a little bit heavier than drizzle. That would be exceptionally pleasant. The problem is, we could get early rain like this and then have a boiling hot October with no rain. And October's usually the hardest month in the bush. It's very, very hot, and it's usually just before the rains have started. This is early rain. We had, at the start of this drought, not last year, but the year before, or not last rainy season, but the rainy season before, this is exactly what happened. We had September rains, and then nothing else afterwards. Hello, Impala. Yes, you're the ones that told me that the lion was there. Looking a little bit damp. I'm sure they're not going to complain, though. Here we go. And Jaina, you wanted to know, wanted me to explain why I don't want a dry December. And the answer to that is because December is our hottest month. October, November, December, January are, obviously it's midsummer for us, it's our hottest time. So what that means is that if we have a dry December, if every day is almost guaranteed, unless it's a day like today, it's almost guaranteed to go above 30 degrees, so 86 Fahrenheit. Most of the time it's closer to 40, and quite often it's over 100 degrees Fahrenheit. I'm going to make sure I get my Celsius and my Fahrenheit not confused. Just heard the elephants again. So if it does stay dry in December, then we lose a huge amount of water to evaporation. That's all it is. We need kind of a constant... Our normal summer rainfall pattern is a hot, hot day, and then it breaks in the form of a thunderstorm. And that is almost... it's a nice, almost invariable pattern. At least four times a week, you'll get a nice big thunderstorm, cloud burst, and then you've sort of fixed the water or replaced the water that's been lost to evaporation. I'm hoping this isn't just early rain. I'm going to stay optimistic. It's very nice that we've had it, and it's very necessary, so I'm not complaining about it at all. It's just that this has happened before. To make up for the drought, we do need a steady, constant rain for a long time. And it kind of needs to be spaced out throughout the year. What do you think, Impala? Do you think they're just happy, I think. They just know that there's going to be fresh green grass. Nice, something nice for them to eat. A little bit more pleasant. even if that means putting up with being a bit damp and cold for now. You can see they are a bit damp. All fluffed up and soggy. Right, let's go to Treehouse Dam. Let's go see how much water's there. We're not far from it at all. And it's one of Karula's favourite haunts, so you never know. Apparently a vula was there. Oh, I forgot to tell you. Apparently a vula was around there yesterday. Oh. Well, before we do that, let's look at the other antelope species that's been hiding here the whole time. There's a kudu. Also all fluffed up and slightly damp. Lovely. All the animals seem to be out in full force. You know it's a chilly morning when the guides are already stopping to give their guests coffee. I can just hear it coming through on the Game Drive channel. Right, onwards to Treehouse Dam. In the meantime, let's hop on board with Taylor. Find out what she's up to.
We have found some go-away birds this morning and they look freezing as well. Look how fluffed up they are, very much like the impala. I think that's what all the animals are going to look like today, is fluffed up. You can see them holding on for dear life as they blow about in the wind. Normally at this time of the morning you'll usually see the go-away birds sitting on the tops of the trees trying to sun themselves and warm themselves up. But this is not the case this morning. I think we're going to see quite a few unhappy birds this morning. Remember yesterday I was chatting about becoming birders and how important it actually is out in the bushes. It's a nice filler. So anybody that hasn't started a bird list, this is a good opportunity too. We've got some go-away birds. We also had some Natal spurfowls earlier. And we'll try and find as many birds as we can today. Though, unfortunately, the sky is not the greatest. You can see it's very grey. So hopefully we'll get them down in between some shrubs and we don't have to look at them against the sky. Otherwise, we're just going to be doing silhouettes of birds. Then I suppose we could be practicing your birding specialist course then. That's something that you have to do when you want to become a birding specialist. They do all these different types of crazy tests, one of them being identifying silhouettes of birds. Blair, good morning to you. I hope you're keeping nice and warm wherever you may be. Blair wants to know what that bird is that makes a strange popping, and well, it makes a strange noise and makes a popping noise at the end of its call like champagne. Now that is a black-bellied bustard. Should we have a look quickly? Let me find it in my book while you have a look at the go-away birds. Let me show everyone a photo. I think I've come unplugged. Yes, I've unplugged myself. You can just give me a few moments. We're also trying to hold down the rain covers this morning. They are blowing about in this wind. Let's see. B for bustard. Where are you? I need to start learning the pages. I think that shall be my next goal. There we go. 156 is the page. Everybody take notes so you can let me know for next time. Hang on. I'm almost there. And here I am. Can you see it? This one over here. That's the black-bellied bustard that has the very champagne-like call. It's a strange noise. I'm not going to try and mimic it this morning because my bird calls are not that great, unfortunately. Well, it would maybe be quite entertaining for all of you at home, so I'll see. Maybe I'll try and work up the courage this morning and try and do my best bird calls. But let's carry on. I have no idea where I'm going this morning, everyone. So much everything is falling apart today. We, Iggy and I, are just really going for a bumble. I don't know if we're going to see any leopards today. I haven't seen any tracks. Obviously, like I said earlier, tracking is quite difficult just because of all the rain that we've had has washed any tracks. However, if a leopard were to come out now and walk on the road, that'd be great. That would make it very easy to track a leopard. ground is now nice and soft. Stay down, rain covers.
Hello.
They're getting very excited, these rain covers. They're flapping all over the show. And it's quite funny to see that Eggsy is actually using the rain covers as a blanket this morning. I'm envious of him. Oh my goodness, everything is coming out. Wind is blowing my earpiece out of my ear. Get back in there. Naughty. Supposed to come out. Been so well behaved the last few days. I think it's the gloves. I can't do anything with gloves on, everybody. As warm as what they are, they make me a hopeless human being trying to trying to navigate. But Eggsy, they're amazing. They're keeping my hands nice and warm. I'm really not prepared for winter. I thought I was coming back into the summer. But obviously with the first rain of the season, which I'm so chuffed about, because I can't complain too much. Right, let's go on. There's some roads I'm not allowed to drive. Let's just make sure. Let's go down this one. Just stay safe. We're going through quite a bit of water, as you can see. Go through nice and slowly, as I don't want to cover Wendy in too much mud. She is a lady, of course. Right. Eggsy, what are we going to look for now? Crocodile. Eggsy says we're going to look for crocodiles. I don't know if we're going to find any crocodiles. It's a bit cold. We may find some logosauruses this morning, though. I think that's a definite that we will see some logosauruses. Let's go through nice and slowly. This wind has got an absolute chill to it, and I'm looking for my frogs, everybody, but I can't find the frogs just yet. I'm hoping by this afternoon, if it does maybe warm up a little bit, we'll get some. Good morning, James Richard. So James is asking that I keep my eye open for an African giant land snail, which should come out after this wet weather. I will definitely try and find you one this morning, James. If not, we'll try and look for a shell. That might be the closest. But it's also very important now that we have had rain. You'll see I'm watching the road extremely carefully, more so than what I normally would, because things like terrapins and tortoises and the frogs are all going to start to come out onto the road, and they'll go into these little puddles that you're seeing in front of us, and I don't want to drive over them. So you've got to be careful. You're looking for any ripples in the puddle that may indicate that there's something inside of it. Very quiet so far. It's just the lions that seem to be out this morning. Right, where are the animals? Well, we know we're one less buffalo. Nothing around here. Let's have a look at this tree to the right. I'm going to try and find a nice little spot here. Should we play a quiz? I actually spoke about this tree yesterday. Let's see if anybody remembers. What tree do we have here? We can see those lovely green leaves. And once you've had a look at the green leaves, if you can go down the base of the tree towards the termite mound. Can you see that? Remember, what trees did I say yesterday that quite enjoy growing out the tops of termite mounds? Can you see that? Goes all the way down and into a big termite mound. I'm going to leave that as a quiz, and hopefully some of you will get it right. And I'll give you one clue. One clue, and that's it. This tree also gets little red flowers. That's it from me. So have a good look. Take a few screenshots. You're welcome to use a book, or you can ask Google too. And that will be, I don't know what the prize will be. You'll get bragging rights. You'll be the tree queen or king. Right, let's see. I don't know where we're going. We'll just take this road and we'll just see how it goes. Who have we got in front of us? We've got a crested Franklin, everybody. Can you see him over there? We've got two crested Franklins pecking away. There they are. Good morning. So our list is growing, everybody. You can see them pecking away, getting any seeds, or, and I suppose now, like they keep saying after the rain, I'm sure there'd be a few little insects that would have had their burrows flooded and are now having to come out into the open. Now they're going to go and dig like chickens under the leaf litter. But no, they're not calling for us like that Shelley's Franklin did last night. That was amazing to see as well. And off they go. So I hope you are keeping a bird list, everybody. We've had go-away birds. We've had Natal Spurfowls now. We've had the Crested Franklins. And I'm sure to see lots more. I can hear lots of birds in the distance. Now we just need to try and find them. And if they can sit nicely on the ground like those Crested Franklins just did, it'll be a great birding morning. And we'll be able to see them and all their different colors quite nicely. Okay, so someone else has driven on this road, which is good news for me. It means that I'm supposed to be driving here. A little bit of a bump. Let me take it easy. Whee. So the driving in this area is much easier than what it is down in the Eastern Cape, where I'm originally from. There's a lot of clay in the soil and it's quite mountainous down in the Eastern Cape. So it made it very interesting when we had, say, if we had the same amount of rain, so we had 40 mils of rain, that would it would really test your 4x4ing skills. Just heard quite a few birds chatting over here. Trying to see if we can see any of them perched on the trees or on the ground. Sounded like a kingfisher that I was hearing, possibly a brown hooded. Let's see, no, nothing that I can see just yet. But Eggsy's also scanning about, helping me look for the birds this morning. We haven't actually even seen any parlor yet. Is unusual. Normally we see them everywhere. I don't know where I am. I think I must maybe just have a quick look just to double check. We've got, are you gonna stay? Are you gonna fly? Don't fly. Just be no, never mind. The turtle dove that I was going to show you disappeared. We'll carry on. Oh, hang on, we've got lots of birds here. All in these big jackalberry trees that you can see. See who we've got. Just gonna get a nice little spot for us quickly. Look at this behavior. I don't know, can you get that, Eggsy? It's quite high up. I'm testing your angles today. We do have two go-away birds up in the tree, but they were quite playful with each other. You can see them just to the top left there. See them? Have a look. Oh no, one has jumped lower down on the branch, but they were sort of pecking each other, which was quite funny, and one was letting off a bit of a call. They seem to have settled down quite nicely now. There are lots of go-away birds. We've even got a hornbill that's come in and joined us. Can you see just right there on the right-hand side, on the edge of the tree? Hey everybody, we're at high angles this morning. We're just trying to manage everything. So if you go a little bit higher, I think. I'm trying to find it. Hang on, let me reposition because it's hiding away quite a bit. We got it. There it is. Whee! I went into... Sorry, I tried to move the vehicle and I went into a bit of a puddle. Here we go. So that is a yellow-billed hornbill that we are looking at. And I doubt we'll be able... Oh, there it flies. And off it goes. Typical. Let's go around to the next jackalberry because there's lots of birds bouncing around in these trees, which is fantastic for us. I'm very excited. A birding morning on this freezing cold day. Up we go. I'm going to stop. Have a look what's going on over there on the edges. There's lots of different birds. I can see some starlings and some more hornbills and some go-away birds. You can see them there. So we've got the hornbills on the yellow-billed hornbills jumping around up top. Probably a male and a female. And then if we go down a little bit, we've got go-away birds. And I did see a starling, but I don't know where the starling has gone now. Oh, there it is. Which starling do we have over there? Can I see your face? No, I'm going to fly away. It looked like it could have been a virtual starling, but I didn't have a proper look at it, I'm afraid. And they, normally at this time of the year, you're seeing a lot of fruit in the jackalberry trees. I haven't really seen too much of it yet, but I think the birds and the monkeys possibly have gotten to these trees before I can, and I love the fruit of the jackalberries. And I haven't seen too many fig trees around here either. Who's that? Is that one of us, our friends, the starlings? They look so funny because we can't see the iridescence that's coming through on their feathers. Yes, it's, we have a, is it that or is it a drongo? Hang on, I need to, I can't see it properly from here. What does everybody think that is? Do we think it is a drongo or do we think it is a starling? Look at us again. I think it's a starling, just because from the shape of the beak, but it is difficult, like I said. Drongo's beak tends to be a little bit more hooked than that, but I could be wrong. Let's see if we can get a better angle. Go around the corner over here, and hopefully they decide to stay. Looking up top, let's see. Yes, it is a starling. I don't know if you can see any better, but I could be wrong. It could not be, maybe it's not even a virtual starling. It's hard to see against the sky. See what I mean when I say birding is not the greatest when you're looking in the sky with it, when it's got that horrible gray background. Okay, well, I can't, now it's hiding its face, so I can't give you an exact answer as to what that actually is. Can you please move? It doesn't look like it has as long of a tail, so maybe it's a Cape glossy starling. And I'm just trying to listen. I think I've got another starling that's maybe in better view. Let's move forward again. Very active here. Oh, hang on. Wait, before we go to the starling, we can see the go-away bird actually dangling from the branches just over here. And you can actually see all the jackalberries. You see that one that was jumping around there. There's lots of jackalberries on this jackalberry tree, obviously. Can you see them there? All those little round balls, those are the fruit. Now, some of them look quite green, so to me that is saying that they are not quite ripe yet. They go a lovely yellow, golden yellow color, and that's when they are at their tastiest. Often I like to pick up the ones that have been on the ground and fermenting for a little bit. They're quite nice to eat. They've got quite a few seeds in them. So you often see things like the jackal and the civets eating all these things. You see the seeds, you see all those seeds in their dung. Judy H, Marianne, Morning Glory, you are indeed correct. So they guessed that the tree was a weeping bourbon, and congratulations, that it is. The jackalberries and the weeping bourbon too. Sometimes they can get confused, are the ones that we often see growing out of termite mounds. And there you can see a Cape glossy starling dangling on for dear life, also trying to peck at all the fruit that's growing on this tree. And I'm going to just sit quietly. I want to see if you can hear all the birds that are shouting around. So I'm going to be quiet for just a few moments. Can you hear any of that? Wonderful, that's good. I've just got some confirmation that you can. There's a hardy dar shouting in the background, and I think it's Natal Spurfowls that are also shouting. And I can actually see one roosting just straight ahead under a fallen log. I don't know if you can see that eggsy waif down from the tree. Wait, no, you about in front of me. There's all go there we go. You see under that log there's a there he is. Hello. Good morning. We're having good luck with watching birds call. Now, of course, here we go. They're just chatting away. I love the speckling that they have on their chest. It's quite beautiful. And there's two of them that are shouting, but I can only just see one. And that's quite a nice little sheltered spot that spurfowl has got out of the wind and off the ground, drying its feathers nicely. The other one has just popped out as well, but I think that other one is going to make its way towards this one that is perched on this fallen tree. that even the birds have to come out on these miserable days in order to keep eating. It's just amazing how nothing stops even when the weather turns bad. Everybody just keeps on keeping on. Goodness, there's lots of birds chirping. Good morning, Zach. Zach is a new viewer, so welcome to the show, and I hope you're enjoying it. And we're so happy that you've tuned in this morning. So Zach wants to know, do any of the animals get depressed by the weather? I think the cats do. I don't think the cats particularly enjoy getting poured on, especially with the rain that we had last night. And there was so much thunder, and that is obviously very loud. So I think the cats, out of them all, are the least happy when there's a lot of rain. Also the reptiles, they're going to have to stay in their burrows. They can't come out and warm themselves up. Depressed, I don't think you could call it depressed. I think it's just a bit disappointed. But also, unfortunately, we obviously watch the animals, but they can't really tell us. We haven't quite learned how to understand the animals, only by just reading their body language. But this morning, I don't know if you managed to see it, Zach, that the lions looked very upset. The ones that weren't eating, they sort of curled themselves and hid their heads underneath their paws. But while I find some more birds for all of you this morning, I'm going to send you on over to Jamie and see how she's going.
Well, I think we should give Taylor a little bit of a hand when it comes to our birding morning. It took us a bit longer than expected to get to Treehouse Dam because we had to attempt to try and fix my microphone, see whether or not we can get it working. So as long as I don't move or turn my head, we seem to be okay. Right, Treehouse Dam. And Treehouse Dam is absolutely massive now. It has been rebuilt up and redesigned and reconstructed, but it does have a considerable amount of water. And what's even better is that it's going to continue pouring into Treehouse Dam as it soaks out from beneath the ground. Oh, Rusty's taking us on a little journey. Let's see if we've got any terrapins. Have they got here yet? It's amazing how fast that will happen. I don't think so. I think that is a piece of grass or branch or... what are those terrapins? Or is it mud? I think it's mud. Yep, I think it's mud, unfortunately. There are no terrapins just yet. It is amazing the speed at which terrapins pop out during the rain and head to bodies of water, whether they be puddles or anything else, which is why it's so important when we're driving through the puddles to make sure that we are quite careful about going very, very slowly so that any terrapin or anything living in the puddles itself will have a chance to get away. Generally, terrapins just surf. We can't go around the puddles because it actually wrecks the roads. It creates a new road, and that in itself is actually more detrimental to the environment than anything else. Not much here at Treehouse Dam. It is going to be a quiet morning. It's just one of those things. Morning after rain is usually very, very quiet. Although the nice thing is, hopefully we could see some big cats on the move, perhaps a big dominant male leopard. Since all of their territorial markings have now been washed off the bushes in terms of scent, they're going to have to come and re-patrol their boundaries. Jeepers, Cheetah Plains had 48 mils of rain. That's amazing. Now, if you have any further questions you would like to ask about our rainfall or about anything that you might see here, please do send them through There's too much talking happening there. On hashtag SafariLive on Twitter or email through to questions@wildearth.tv. So if there are any people who are jumping on board the stream for the first time, perhaps this is your first experience with it, you are able to ask questions. It is interactive. But please do. Don't be shy. Let us know where you're from if it's your first time watching. Even if you don't believe it's live. We've had that once or twice. It's hilarious to answer. So please, if you don't believe that we're live, please feel free to send through a question. My favorite one was when we were still starting in the dark in the mornings, and somebody sent through, "Ha, we've caught them out. First it was dark and now it's light." That is how mornings work. That's what happens when the earth rotates. It's very funny. Hey, Dave, we're on the lookout for birds this morning, apparently. Whoa. And trees, watch the tree. Somehow I don't think I should injure Dave on his birthday. No scratches from thorns today. I'm Karen. Hello and welcome to the sunrise safari, presumably. The sun has risen at some point, we just didn't get to see it. He wants to know if there are any peacocks in the Sabi sand. And the answer is no, there aren't. They are not indigenous to this area, indigenous to India. There are introduced populations of peacocks. There are some wandering around throughout Johannesburg as feral populations. People buy them as pets and then they have released them. Well, they've released themselves, given that they are birds, and they can fly, even if it's a clumsy flight, into the wilderness. And while we look at these waterbuck, I just want to find a picture of something to show you. Get all my books out of their waterproof box and just have a look. They look happy with life. They're prepped for this as waterbuck. Dealing with the rain is something that they do quite well. They've got that oily cover around their coat which helps to waterproof them. And actually, it might be my imagination, but these guys look a little bit drier than the impala do. And that's just because they're adapted to live in water. Not in water, they're not like penguins. But they do spend a lot of time wandering through rivers and into dams. There's nice soft vegetation, hence the name waterbuck. Less so in the northern Sabi sands, but they definitely do move about in water. So in order to prevent their fur from getting waterlogged, they have a nice oily waterproof substance on their fur, which keeps them nice and dry and smelly. Right, Karen, have a look at this. We might not get peacocks here in South Africa, but there is something called a Congo peacock. And as the name suggests, it is endemic to the Democratic Republic of Congo. This is the male. It's okay, it's not quite the long streaming tail of the peacocks that we normally think of. And there's also, that's what the female looks like, just up a little bit. That's the female. I love the head spike, don't you? Isn't that amazing? I've never seen a Congo peacock. I love the tufts on the top of their head. They're hilarious. Head tufts, the book describes them as. So foraging on the rainforest floor, and very little is known about them. And then, this is my favorite thing to do with bird books, the description of a bird call. And this is quite funny. I think Taylor could chime in with this as well. Whenever you read it, unless you've heard the bird call itself, it doesn't make any sense. So the voice is described as a repeated duet, go away, go ah, go away, go ah. Let's do the next one. Actually, this is quite a fun game. That's the go away, go ah sound. I sort of get the idea. Let's go down to our helmeted guinea fowl. So the one that we see, a loud kick kick car, or ke car ke car, or a monotonous repeated kridi kridi, or an alarm note kick kick kick. If you've never heard a guinea fowl, I'm sorry, I love bird books, I love the ornithologists that put bird books together, but if you've never heard that bird before, that makes absolutely no sense at all. I want to look up Hardy Dog, although Hardy Dog is a pretty easy one. So a guinea fowl actually goes. So I think that's what they were describing with the monotonous repeated kridi kridi. And then the kick 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 alarm call is when they go. And so on. You get the idea. So the way that bird calls are written doesn't necessarily translate into real life. Bill, he wants to know, on the subject of sort of common town birds, although I'm not sure, I suppose I wouldn't call a peacock a common town bird, Do we have any crows? Yes, we do. I've seen them twice while I've been here. Once was scavenging off a buffalo carcass with a huge amount of vultures. And the second was when I was doing a bushwalk sometime. When we said we saw trumpeter hornbills, if you cast your mind back to whenever that was, it all blurs into one. Then we saw crows flying overhead a couple of times. So we do get pied crows. They are ubiquitous throughout the world, I think. They just seem to be everywhere, highly, highly adaptable. Most of the time, though, you'll see them if you drive through the townships or through the town itself. Then you'll see far more of the pied crows picking off roadkill and so on. So yes, we do get crows here. I wonder what the book says for a crow call. Hold on one moment. Crow, sea, cisticula, cliff chat, crake, trombic, crow. 388. A loud quaw or quark. Quaw or quark. Quark. How would you say that, Dave? Crook. That's much nicer. Crook. Loud quaw or quark. There you go. One more, just because I'm entertaining myself now. Let me just look up pearl-spotted owlet. I want to see how they describe that. One of them, the chin-spotted abatis, is described as saying three blind mice, which, if you have never heard it before, does not make any sense at all. When does O go in the alphabet? Owlet. Pearl-spotted 244. I'll pop this back on the dashboard. Make Dave's life a bit easier. Right, our little pearl-spotted owlet. That's what a pearl... Oh, sorry. Yep, there we go. All done. That's what a pearl-spotted owlet looks like. And then it says, a series of low toots, rising in pitch, two, 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 two. Then a brief pause followed by, okay, piercing down-slurred whistles, chew, chew, okay. That's actually quite a good one. Fair enough, that's not a bad description. I want to see if Taylor's got any more that you might think of. While we drop to head off and check on twin dams, let's go back across to Taylor, see what she's up to with her birding.
I've decided I'm not doing any bird calls this morning because I got the rain. Now, Jamie, game on. A little bird told me yesterday that Jamie's never done a rain dance before. And I don't think we've had enough rain yet, so I think we need some encouragement from everybody to try and get Jamie to do a rain dance for you this morning. Or if she's up to it, maybe we can always meet up and we can do one together. But I think she should do her own solo and then we can try and choreograph something and maybe do it for you this afternoon. But we'll see. I'll have to have a chat to her about that at breakfast. Now, I have no idea where I am, everybody. Again, I keep getting lost. As long as I'm just not driving off of our traverse, I'm happy to just keep bumbling. So I just want to double check again. No, I can't because I'm driving and you should never text and drive. Not that I'm texting, should I put my code in my mobile? Right, let's see who is out and about. I can see a big bird of prey flying around, but I haven't been able to identify it just yet. It keeps flapping away from us. I don't know if you can see it up top over there. It's flying directly ahead of us and in the distance. Should see like a little black spot. Let's see who it is. It's very difficult with this dark sky. I can't even tell you what color it is. It looks like it is brown. It's probably a Wahlberg's eagle because it doesn't look particularly big. I'm going to go with a Wahlberg's eagle. It looks quite small, in fact. But it can't be too sure. Like I said, it just looked brown and just saw the silhouette of it. Oh, we've got some waterbuck up ahead. Good morning, waterbuck. Try and get a good view. Let's go stealth mode. Don't run away, please. We just want to have a look at you because you're the first waterbuck I've seen all morning. And it's a young one. Hello, little one, where's your mum? I'm sure the rest of the herd is lurking just in the distance. You can see this little one doesn't look very impressed with how, look at its wet bum still, wet coat, everything hasn't quite dried. Though this wind is acting like a hairdryer at the moment, especially when you do have a shaggy coat like a waterbuck. What are you doing? Sometimes what mom will do, though this calf looks slightly older than, oh no, here we go. Here comes mom, just about to poke her head out of the bushes. So normally what happens when a waterbuck is quite young, and it happens with quite a few of the antelope species, mom will actually drop the little one off in a drainage line somewhere in some thick bushes, an entire herd coming out, which is fantastic, and leave them there, and then she'll go and feed off into the distance, because predators will associate calves being at the foot of a mother normally. And if they hide those little ones away, they may have a better chance of surviving. That's normally just until they can handle their legs properly and they can actually run and keep up with the rest of the herd. You can see here comes another juvenile. So far I've just seen two adult females and two of these juvenile waterbuck. But those little ones are really so fluffy, much fluffier than the adults. So they've still obviously got their baby coat, which I'm sure will start to thin out in the next few months. And there you go, off they go. And watch how, when this little one disappears into the thicket, how that white ring that is on a waterbuck's bum is the only thing that you can sort of see. That, and I don't know if you can see on the side of its face, just down and below its eyes, is another white streak of hair. I've actually just noticed that. You know, it stands out quite nicely in the bush as well. It seems to be more prominent on the little ones. On the adults, it's not quite as white and as obvious. But that white ring is very important if they do go darting off into this thicket that they're moving into. That white ring will obviously stand out quite nicely, like you can see there. That's sort of all you can see. And that's what the other members of the herd will be using to try and follow each other. So those are called follow me signs. We saw it nicely yesterday, where we saw the black markings on the ears of the lions, as well as the black tip on the tail. Oh, here comes another one. Oh, this is nice. There's actually quite a few of them coming out of this little drainage line. Over here comes another female. Good morning. There you go. Stop, listen, smell, just to check. And that's something that you'll see the animals doing quite often, especially the antelope species. They will walk, 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 and then they'll pause briefly, scan around them, listen, also see if they can pick up any new scents, and then they will carry on moving. And that's what they have to keep doing. We actually saw it quite nicely two afternoons ago with the herd of zebra that we waited for about an hour and a half until they came down to drink. They didn't feel quite comfortable and they wanted to just make sure that there weren't any predators lying around before they made that steep descent to the water, which is very clever of them. You don't actually see, or in this area, I haven't seen too many lions feeding on zebras. I think I've only actually seen it twice. So they must be doing something right. There's a few more waterbuck coming out of the thicket. They're still just making their way though. And as they come out of one thicket into the clearing, they move straight back down into another thicket to keep out of this miserable wind that we have this morning. You can see their coats blowing quite nicely in the wind. Lovely. Now, one thing I want you all to do is, when you see an area, like for instance, perhaps this patch over here, take a screenshot. Just so that you can see how dry the ground is, and try and take a screenshot every day. Maybe we will try and do that. Just before we head back, we'll stop on quarantine and let's make a plan. Let's stop at the same spot every day for the next week, and everybody takes a screenshot. And maybe you can put a collage or something together and hashtag Safari Live once you've made a collage, so we can see how quickly the grass has come through and see the changes. That's quite nice to do. So I'll maybe try and mark out an area with my brain on quarantine, and we'll maybe choose a big tree or something, like a marker that we can remember where to stop every morning and every afternoon, and then we'll see how that goes. I think that's quite a nice challenge, and I don't know if anybody has done that with you. So for those of you who have just tuned into the show, welcome. My name is Taylor again, and we've got Eggsy on camera, and you are welcome to have a chat with us. I'd love to hear from you. It's a bit cold, a bit slow this morning. The animals haven't quite woken up after all that the stormy night. And so if you'd like to send in any questions, you can either hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or we're also available on email, so you can send your questions to questions@wildearth.tv. And I really look forward to hearing from you. We're going to leave these water butts now. They have completely disappeared down into a drainage line. We're going to carry on with this road, which I have no idea where we're going, but we're just going to drive on it. At the moment, it doesn't even look like a road because the rain has just washed away any of the little ruts, which is quite nice. You can actually see, have a look at these mud wallows that we have over here, just to the left. Ooh, my goodness, you see those rain covers, they're attacking. And the water buck, I've also got a bit of a fright. I think that could have been the sound of the rain covers rustling. Sorry about that, everybody. And I wanted to show you these mud wallows. Now, mud wallows are actually created on days like this. Obviously, we've had quite a bit of rain, as you can see. And the ground is nice and soft now. So all it takes is an elephant to come marching on along and to walk on some of this soft ground. And obviously an elephant is quite big and it will leave a big indentation in the muddy surface. And on a nice hot day, like maybe tomorrow or the next day, when there's still a bit of water in that footprint, something like a warthog may come through and go, oh, fantastic, this is a perfect size to fit my bum inside, and give it a little wiggle. And then they may have a little mud bath in that, and then it widens. All that mud is being dug out and popped out onto the sides, and then maybe a family of warthogs comes through and does the same thing. And eventually these holes get deeper and deeper. Like if you go to a little bit to the left, you can see that there's a smaller one, and then obviously on the right you've got the nice big one. So now you can see the size comparisons, and eventually you'll get things like rhinoceros, buffalo, elephants all coming through and wallowing and having mud baths, which creates these mud wallows. Now, I was telling Eggsy that it's going to be great when the weather does start to get hot again, because these wallows are going to hold this water for a few days, and we know how much the buffalo love to wallow in the water, so it's going to be great. We're going to hopefully be seeing lots of different species of animals coming down and enjoying this little natural bath, I suppose it is. And even the starlings, that's actually something I'm going to be looking out for, with the Cape Glossy starlings, which has to be one of my favorite birds. When they come through in flocks and they come down and have a little bathe in the mud wallows like this, that's always quite entertaining. So that's something that we're going to be looking out for in the next few days as well. Right, let's carry on. And see what else we can find. Thank you for those water buck though. Thank you, nature, because it was very quiet. My body's not quite used to the fluctuations in temperature. 1 minute it's hot, next minute it's freezing cold. Oh no, now we are at a junction. I think I'm going to have to whip out the trusty GPS and just have a quick look over here. Let's go and see how Jamie's doing at Twin Dams.
Well, Taylor decides whether she wants to go left or right. We're going straight ahead along Twin Dams to see what we can see. And I think our next trip will be Biffleshook Dam. I was going to stop off at our Barbet's Nest, until I realized I'm not allowed to drive across the dam wall. So I'm not allowed to drive there, unfortunately, at the moment, just because the roads are in a delicate state right now, as are certain other areas. So, for example, if we had lions somewhere around this drainage line, but not in the drainage line itself, we'd have to be very, very careful about how we drove through there, because we could actually end up doing some serious damage to the top layer of soil and actually contributing to the erosion that's happening around this drainage line. And I'll try and find a spot and I'll show you exactly what I mean. So it's a whole different ball game driving around on wet roads. Christine, we're sort of going from one extreme to the other. You want to know how often we get flooding in the Sabi Sand. The last big flood, if I'm not very much mistaken, was 2012 here. There was... Sorry, I'm trying to work out what that is. Oh, it's a very happy Egyptian goose. Sorry, Dave. keep you on your toes. One very happy Egyptian goose, flapping off. Well done, Dave. The last one, big one, was 2012, when I was working on Makalali, which was 2013-14. There were massive, massive floods in that area. The whole of Hoedspruit was shut down. Couldn't get to Hoedspruit. The Zandspruit River flooded. It was quite entertaining. Somebody's been playing skid. Look at the mud, look at the tracks. Should we go, Dave? It's our turn now. Yeah. It's our turn now. Okay. Yay. So much fun. That was a particularly interesting flood because I was trapped. I was on leave and I'd gone to visit a friend in a place called Liverpool, not the English Liverpool, obviously, and I got completely stuck. Okay. Please don't let us get stuck now. I'll be so embarrassed. Whee! Sliding all over the show. I got stuck in Liverpool and I had to get my... I've got a very old RAV4 that I got from my mum. And that RAV4 has been in our family since I was 11. And I took it when I was old enough to start driving around. And an old RAV4 that I had to get through these incredibly flooded river passes. It was unbelievable. I had water flowing over my feet. Testament... Oh, I better not say this, should I? I'm not doing... No product placement, sorry. No further discussion about that. Anyway, my old little car did beautifully. That was the last big flood. The river crossings on Makalali were 6-7 meters underwater. The lodges washed away and closed for about... Sure, those were closed for close to 4 or so months. We found all kinds of interesting things. Because obviously, after a big flood like that, you get... Oh, little Dacre. Oh, it's running away. Was sleeping. Sorry, little Dacre. We'll see it now. There we go. One damp Dacre. There you go. Hello, girl. Yes, I'm a jolly good groom. A female Dacre with a much smaller mohawk than normal. Usually the females have long, straight mohawks in the middle of their heads. Hers was quite tiny. But flooding and rivers, obviously they flow from somewhere, and quite often that's through different villages and so on, and then through the reserves. And that means it brings, unfortunately, a pile of debris down. And so we played a game called River Cleanup Bingo. And we drew up bingo cards. It was things like shoes and whatever else, bottles. And you got a certain number. You got every person got a bingo card, and off we went to go and clean up the river. Tires, buckets, some things that are not mentionable. And other things as well. It was very interesting to find placemats, lamps. And we do get occasional huge floods. There was a massive, massive flood in the early 2000s in the Kruger National Park. I remember seeing it on the news as a child. And if you go to the Kruger National Park now, somebody's driven here already, let's drive here then. I don't like, you know, if we can avoid driving down roads, people have already driven down. Makes sense. If you go to Kruger National Park now and you stop at the rivers, there's a painted line on the roads that marks the flood levels. And if you go to places, at certain camps, there's flood lines painted on the buildings with signs saying either the 2012 or 13 flood and the early 2000s flood. So it does occasionally flood. One thing I can guarantee, if we have normal rains this year, at some point we will be stranded, we will not be able to get out of camp, and at some point our food order will not arrive. It's just the way of things. The roads get closed, they're impassable. It's just a reality. What little bird is sitting over there? I can't even see. You see it there, Dave? Bright white tummy. There, it's looking very fluffed up. It's a puffback. Oh, that's a chagra. That's a little chagra. our puffback, if you go up, Dave, is in the buffalo thorns above that. There. Thank you very much. That's a blackback puffback, also known as a puffed back shrike. And we don't often get to have a close look at them, so this is actually quite exciting, with their bright cherry red eye. And named, of course, for the fluffy white patch that sits under the black along its back. Come on, fluff yourself up for us. Fluff yourself up. Show them your puff back. Aw, I saw it earlier. It did do it just a moment ago. Oh, and gone. Let me just show you a picture in my book. I will also do their call for you, but I will do the literal call, as I've decided it is, as written. Sorry, hold on one moment. I've forgotten how the alphabet works. Shrike, puffback. Where is it now? What did I say it was called? Puffback. It's the new name. Puffback, there we go. 580. So there we go. And that is our blacked back puffback. And that is the fluffy white of a displaying male. And that, by the way, I think was a male. It was definitely a male, sorry. He was displaying. And there we have his puffed back puff over there. It looks like a little fluffy, a dandelion almost. That's why it's called a puffback. Ooh, Taylor's laying down the gauntlet this morning. She says she can do a better blackback puffback call this morning. I think Taylor's missed the point of the fact that I'm doing literal translations of calls as written, because it's much funnier. Chick-wurr, chick-wee-oo, 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 chick-wee-oo. So it is actually a bill snap. They've got a bill snap that they have going on. Right, Taylor, you've laid down the gauntlet. Let's see if your call is better than mine. We'll wait, have to wait and see. Of course, the master of the call himself has flown away. I can't do a blackback puffback call. I can't do it. I'd have to hear it and then try and imitate it back. It does have a nice bull snap to it. All right, Taylor. Laying down the gauntlet this early on a Sunday morning. Let's hear her puffback shrike call.
So just before I do my black-backed puffback call, can you see we managed to find two Dugger boys moving through a very dense patch of trees, unfortunately, and they are disappearing. But at least we very quickly got to see another mammal. Right, now for my call, everybody. You're going to have to be the verdicts here, everybody, so send in your comments what you think. So now I have to tell you before I do my call, different birds have different accents. It sounds quite silly, but it's like you and I, we all speak in a different way. Now up in this area, the blackback puffbacks sound different to the ones that I used to see down in the Eastern Cape. So this is going to be the northern South African blackback puffback call. Okay, you ready? Now I've been practicing for about the last 5 minutes. So I think they sound like this. So for those of you who have maybe got a bird app or something along those lines, or are familiar with the sound of a blackback puffback, that is my guess as to what they sound like. And now that I've also done a bird call, I believe that Jamie refused to do her rain dance. Now she's got no legs to stand. I'll even do another one. What other bird call could I possibly do? Should we try to do a fish eagle? I can only try and whistle it. That's my attempt at a fish eagle. Now I've done two birds. Jamie, you better start practicing that rain dance, my friend. It's always nice to have a little bit of banter, like Jamie says, early on a Sunday morning. It looks like we've got some birds up ahead. Let's see who we've got. It looks like a fork-tailed drongo who has just flown away and now it's gone. So I cannot show you anymore. Birding is probably the most difficult, trying to catch them on camera because they never seem to hang around for very long. So I have to ask the ladies in final control, what did you think of my call? I just want to hear a little whisper in my ear. Thank you. So Rebecca in final control, she says that my northern South African blackback puffpack was a great call. She says she wants to hear the variation from the Eastern Cape. Now, they didn't do that clicking, whistling sound at all. They did something completely different. Now, I don't know if I can even remember, but I remember how I used to hear it, and it always used to sound like they were going kill, 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 kill. This very high-pitched and strange noise, and that's how I remember it. So that's not really a call because I'm just saying a word. I'll have to practice that one and maybe try it this afternoon. Trying to think what other bird calls I can do for you, seeing as I am being so silly this morning. So embarrassing, everybody. All my friends that watch me do the rain dance, they're never letting me live it down. So I hope that you enjoyed that dance that I did yesterday. Let's see, who else have we got here? Izzy, have you seen any more birds? No, me neither. I think the wind has taken them away from us. And those buffalo were very rude. They didn't want to hang around. They were there for a whole of about 30 seconds. But I suppose, like I say, can't blame them. It's windy. It's not fun being out in the open. You can see me. I've got my big, thick jacket on this morning. And I must say that this is the first actual waterproof jacket that I've bought. The other ones say that they're waterproof, but I still get wet. And this one's quite a good one. I'm very impressed. That and a black garbage bag works really well too. So you'll probably save your money and just use one of those. Oui. But bumpy. Now I don't know where to go. Where are we going to go? Because I don't want to drive on any roads that I'm not supposed to. I have to very quickly have a look to remember my coat. Right, where are we? I think we're in this junction. So everybody, I need to follow it. So you're going to see me looking at my screen, trying to navigate. We want to carry on going straight, I think. I think that's a good idea. Let's see, I just want to make sure that we get past this junction and I'm doing the right thing, because we're coming up to some roads now that we are not going to drive on. Just probably because they've got a black cotton soil and we don't want to do any sinking. Oh, and down we go. Roller coaster, we are, everybody. Look who I've just spotted. Right, I'm going to challenge Jamie to a rain dance right now. She's not going to be able to get away from this, everybody. Hello. How are you? I'm very well. So did you hear that I've done a whole lot of bird calls? So are you going to do that rain dance for us quickly?
Tires and washing vehicles.
Yes. Was that the right answer? Should we do a combined rain dance?
No, I think you guys should do one together.
I love how the cameraman, birthday David is full of advice this morning. He's exempt from today.
You guys should do one together.
I think, okay, because I think David needs to join us. Yes, we've got, no, come on, out you go, right, everybody.
Are we doing this?
Yes.
Okay, well, you know the
right. So we've had a request from Elizabeth, everybody, from Singapore, and she thinks that David Downpour needs to join us for the dance. So out you get, and let's try and do this dance. We haven't choreographed anything, everybody, so this is going to be an interesting... Are you going to take it off?
Yeah, it's fine, otherwise I'll break. The animals aren't playing, so you can just watch us jump around like maniacs.
Okay. Come on, we need a stage. We need a stage. Is the whole world my stage? There's lots of thorns on the trees, though.
Yes, it's quite cold.
It is quite cold. This is going to warm us up, though.
That's true. Oh,
David's got no shoes on.
He's wearing shorts as well.
I know. We are crazy this morning.
So,
are you ready for this?
Yes.
Are you trying to get those legs working? But where are we going to do this?
Just right here, I reckon.
Yeah. Is this our stage? As Eggsy points. Okay, but I have to take the gloves off in case maybe a handstand or a cartwheel comes out this time. Wait, are they going in the pockets quickly, everybody? We're warming up. Okay, who's going to make noise for us, though? We need some music. Eggsy, we need music. Right, are we ready? Okay, go. That was amazing. I'm going to do 1, 2, and jump. And why not? And little ballerina turns. Woo! We've all done it. Well done. And we're doing a rain dog. Little bit of exercise. Isn't this amazing? I did the can-can yesterday as well. Let's do the can-can. Come on.
Okay,
Downpour day, we're doing the can-can. Come. Because you've got to obviously do the
right leg
first.
Okay. There we go.
Oh, there we go.
I know, we're not insane. Right, everybody, this is why we do this in the bush and we are not dancers. Though, Jamie, you used to be a dancer. So show us one of, what, were you modern ballet?
I'm a ballet dancer.
Okay, one move, one ballet move.
One move? I think I can do anything.
Anyone. It'll break.
Yeah. I'll do a handstand for you.
Okay, well, there we go.
That's what I'm going to do.
That's fine. What are you doing? Okay, Jamie's gonna do a handstand. Go, Jamie! Whee! That was awesome!
So
very nice, they got little hearts on them. Strawberries! Ooh, yum! Sounds delicious. Okay, good teamwork, guys. Good teamwork. And one for AZ for being the best cameraman in the world. Okay, now everybody, I need to get in and plug my lifeline. I hope you... I'm going to be washing vehicles and changing tires for a long time and making probably lots of coffee as well. But at least I did it with you and I didn't let you do it on your own. Everybody, I hope you all enjoyed that. I know, and we're going to have to go back early. If it does, it's Jamie's fault, not mine. Right. Whew, that was good. I'm warm now. I'm not even cold. I don't even need gloves anymore. Okay, I'll see you later. Bye. Two sugars and milks, she shouts as we drive away. Well, everybody, I hope you enjoyed that. It was lots of fun. And I don't know if I'm actually working, because I obviously did cartwheels and things, so sorry, I need to just double check everything is on. Yes. Whoo! Goodness gracious, gym done for the day. No, I'm just joking, everybody, it's not, that doesn't count. Now, where to go next? We'll just carry on straight and see where this takes us. Oh my goodness, can't believe we actually did that, everybody. But it's done. No going back. Right, birdies, where are you? I'm still just laughing to myself, everybody. No animals around here. Not sure if this is the way that Jamie actually came from. Okay, everybody, while I catch my breath and try and salvage what's left of my name, let's go back to Jamie and see how she's doing after that little dance.
No, we don't have audio either. Go, Dave, go.
I've got you on that mic so we can hear you.
Oh, you can hear me. Cool. Yeah. Dave is currently fixing something on my microphone. So with dignity intact, sort of, the team of Rusty trundles onwards. Well done, Dave. It was very, very sporting of you. Sorry to do that to you on your birthday. Blame Taylor.
I will.
But yes, all is well. We're all intact. My back is complaining slightly at the sudden motion after a cold morning. Yeah, okay. We're going to send you back across to Taylor because this microphone is doing odd things. We'll catch up with you soon.
Right, so just as you left me, I managed to find this little African land snail shell. And I know James Richard this morning was asking if we could keep an eye out for one that was actually alive. Now, unfortunately, I haven't seen anything, or any ones that are moving, but I managed to find this one that's half buried in the ground. And the reason why you will see an African land snail coming out after the rains is, especially during the dry periods, or if, for example, we've been having a drought, what they'll do is they'll sort of estivate and they will form a mucous membrane over the entrance of the shell and actually live inside of their shell, and in that, and it'll keep them nice and moist, and they can stay like that for up to 2 years. So they're sort of waiting for the conditions to get better again. And I'm pretty sure once they've come out of that estivating period, they will lay lots and lots of eggs. So they're actually hermaphrodites, so there's no male or female. They're sort of the same. One snail can produce a whole lot of eggs. So they drop thousands and thousands of eggs, and they're actually one of the most invasive species of snails in the world. Obviously, you get different variants of the giant land snails, but they're up in the top 10 most invasive species in the world. But thankfully for us, lots of different things like to eat them. And something that you may be familiar with, I'm sure in the coming now into the summer months, you're going to start seeing lots of little flashing lights after we've had some rain as the sun goes down. And those are fireflies, and the larvae of the firefly actually feeds on snails. So normally they will eat smaller African land snails and then actually utilize that shell as a home afterwards, which I think is quite interesting. Right, now we're going to carry on. It's gone very cold again. I needed to do a little bit more of the jumping around. So I hope you enjoyed that. And I look forward to looking at the comments about our dance a little bit later. As we bumble along here, just going to keep an eye out for some kudu or some impala perhaps. I think I'm still going straight. I may just have to check again. I think so. Yes. Are we going straight? We're not going anywhere because I'm on the map. Where am I? Yes, still going straight, everybody. Radio. So I haven't really heard too much about the update of those lions. So possibly when I get an opportunity, I'm going to jump onto the radio and just figure out which channel they are on, and see if we possibly can't go and pop back past them just to have one more glimpse before the end of the show. But I do know that there were loads and loads of vehicles hoping to see lions. Some of the guides who work further south of us, apparently they hadn't seen lions for quite some time. So I know that they were absolutely excited to be able to see them. We are so fortunate. We pretty much have seen them kahuna since I've been here every single day. I think barring one day we didn't see them. Maybe it was even just one game drive that we didn't see them. So I'm so happy about that. Everybody always says that the game viewing down in the south is a lot better up than what it is up in the north. Well, I'm starting to disagree. I've had some unbelievable sightings, and I've seen a lot of first things as well. So I think everything is changing for the good. So I wonder where those leopards are hiding, because we haven't seen very many leopards now. We had, I suppose, we had Karula and her cubs yesterday, which was quite nice. Right. Everybody, I think Jamie has managed to sort her audio out while I try and find out what's happening with the kahumas. I think head on over to her and I'll let you know if we can pop back and see the cats.
Sorting it out is all a relative term, because this mic is still causing us problems. Sorry, Dave, these rollers are having such a fight. Ah, and they've stopped. Wait, they might keep going. I'm hoping our audio is back up and running. Is it working? Okay.
Oh, goodness, the joys. Okay. Rollers have just stopped as I tried to pull over. They were furiously shouting at each other and doing the display that the rollers get their name from. They're much better at dancing than we are, and doing that gentle side-to-side rocking motion that they do. I was just asking Dave why it is that we decided to run in a circle. That's not even dancing. It doesn't even make any sense. Oh, there they go. They're mobbing. They're actually mobbing something as well. Oh, goodness. Come this way. Come this way. They're very cross about something. It might be... There we go. You got the half a roll. Well done, Dave. What are they mobbing? Oh, they're mobbing each other. Try two on your radio, try two. No problem, you may have to be closer to hear them. Okay, our rollers are fussing about. Sorry about that, I just had to grab my Game Drive channel quickly so that I could help Taylor out with what Game Drive comms she needs to use in order to ask about the Nkuhuma sighting. Shame, she found herself in the middle of a main road sighting, which is always quite difficult because we manage it on different radio channels. I feel like my mic is now trying to climb into my chin. Sorry, there you go. Oh dear, Dave, if I put it under the wheels of the car, am I going to get into trouble? Probably, yes. All right, so that's not the solution. Violence is not the answer. Okay, it seems to be working for now. We seem to have isolated, at least on this particular occasion, what the problem is. It's a very bad connection with the cable, so we've just taped it back together. When in doubt... Oh, gone. Did I mess with it? When in doubt... Here we go. Found its way through the bushes eventually. And speaking of daycare... No word yesterday after Karula disappeared away from that sighting with her cubs, away from the baboons that chased them from their kill. They'd completely disappeared. I don't know why the waterbuck are all running away. I think it's just herd panic moving away from the wind. So Karula disappeared. It's impossible for us to track a leopard in this weather. With waterlogged roads like this, a leopard is not going to leave a footprint. Yes, it's very, very difficult to track. Now we'll have to wait until it dries out a little bit. Or bump into her. We might have to wait until it dries out and we can see their tracks in the road. Just think, Dave, if Taylor had gone... Where did she go? She went right. If she'd gone left instead... No, sorry, she went left, judging by her tire tracks. If she'd gone right instead, we would never have had to rain dance. Oh, I'm joking. I knew we were going to get roped into it. I knew I was going to get roped into it at some point. Just bringing up the suspense, building the suspense. Okay. Actually, before we get to Buffelshoek Dam, there's another water point, and that is Gwari Pan Road. The nice thing about us trundling along here is, judging by the car tracks, or lack thereof, nobody has driven here. And it's always a good place to check. It's where the Nkuhumas had a buffalo kill when I first started working for Wild Earth. Feels like a very long time ago now. Back when there were still eight of them. Okay, the Ellies have been around. Lots of elephant dung in the road, so we might get an elephant herd before the end of the sunrise safari. Weather like this, you know that most of the animals are hiding. Even the birds are often hiding away, sheltering from the wind, finding a nice, safe spot. Oh dear, I think Mike's just stopped for a coffee break at Buffalzook Dam. I'm sure he won't mind if we come and just have a quick peek at the dam itself. There we go. Morning Glory says the last time that she remembers it raining, we stopped and found a Karula drinking from a puddle in front of us. Well, let's hope that that occurs again this morning. I'm trying to think of when that was. I don't remember when the last rains were. We had a little funny rain in the middle of June or July, didn't we? Unexpected, odd seasonal rain, out of season rain. Sorry everybody, just listening to the game drive updates, making sure I haven't missed anything. But it doesn't seem like it. It seems everybody's having a quiet morning. Here we go, there's Gwari Pan. The pan for which Gwari Pan gets its name. Any terrapins? Nope. No terrapins. Wonder where they all are. They've all gone into east. They all would have been in east evasion, hiding underneath trees and stumps. Bill, in Nevada, you wanted to know what the difference is between a terrapin and a turtle. And a tortoise, of course. But the Chelonians, and I'm just going to see if I have my Chelonian. I do have my Chelonian book. Mm-hmm. Tortoises, terrapins, and turtles of Africa. So a tortoise is, sorry, I'm going to go into tortoises as well. There is a tendency, particularly in other parts of the world, to use the word turtle to describe absolutely every Chelonian, including tortoises and terrapins. Tortoise is terrestrial, it's got feet. The only species of tortoise that we have here that can swim is the leopard tortoise, and they move about on land. Turtle has flippers, only comes onto land to lay eggs, and is purely aquatic, swims in the ocean. A terrapin has got clawed webbed feet and goes swimming as well as can walk over land. So it's kind of the in-between, the terrapin and the tortoise combination. I'm trying to think if there's a page in here about the difference. No. There's a whole key, but that's going to be a little bit too complex. I don't think we're going to go into the full details of the key to the Chelonian families in Africa. So there's a couple of differences. Our terrapins usually draw... I'm not going to even show you this, sorry, I'm going to close this book. The terrapins draw their heads sideways into their shells. The tortoises go in to their shells, retract inwards. And the turtles cannot retract their heads at all. They cannot retract their heads and their feet into their shell. Or their flippers, I should say. I'm going to go look for some terrapins in Buffalzook Dam. Meantime, let's head across to the Rain Queen, Rain Dance Queen, and find out where she is.
I do prefer Rain Queen, and I'm glad I'm not being called the Ice Queen. So that's all right, I'll take that. Though I think David Downpour is to thank for all the wonderful rain that we got. His predictions were spot on, everybody. So I think if you need any weather advice, you should definitely ask Dave. So what we're going to do now is I'm trying to get a little bit closer to where this lion sighting is to see if I can try and poke my nose in just for a few more minutes. So I'm just having a little listen. Give me just 30 seconds just to quickly hear what's going on. I don't think I can get hold of them just yet. I think we're still a little bit further away. I think there's quite a bit of interference that's coming off of from this wind. Nah, can't really hear too much. Let me quickly see if I can get a word in. Can any mobile copy me? Andrews, is there any possibility for a standby for those? I'm on Zoe's Road. Cubby, thank you. Right, everybody. We have managed to get a standby position available for this lion sighting. There's obviously lots of guys who are still trying to get through the sighting. So we will see if we make it in time. Otherwise, we're just going to have a little bumble around and see what else we can find in the meantime. Ooh, it's a bit loud. Woo! Goodness gracious. Got lots of voices talking in my head this morning. Oh, I can hear some bamblers, everybody. Let's see if we can get a view of them. I can see one. Don't fly away now. Forward again. No, you're going to fly to the next one. Can you see that one that's perched up? I don't know how long it's going to stay on the branch for. There they are. See them hopping and flying around. So that was... In fact, you can see them, actually, if you zoom right in, straight over there, you may see them on the ground and down and to the left. They were hopping there. They are hopping about there. So that's a flock of arrow-marked babblers, and I'm not sure if you caught them calling, but they are loud, chattery birds, as their name suggests. Babblers, they are funny-looking little birds, and they are quite comical, too. Remember I was telling you the story about how we've got a group of arrow-marked babblers that plague us at the DRC. Look at that one, it's just turning over all the leaves just to see if there's little any insects that are perhaps coming out of the ground. Like I said, all their burrows would have definitely been flooded at the moment, so they'll all be coming to the surface. So they look quite happy fluttering around in that leaf litter over there. There you go, find some more. But it's quite a difficult view with all these different trees, and they are quite a distance away from us. So we're slowly adding birds to the list. I know that Brent and James have been doing a bird list for quite some time now. So I'm hoping to find some unusual birds. I don't think today we'll find too many unusual birds, but as the weather warms up, to add to that bird list. There we go, you can see them now. Congratulations, Terry. I'm going to roll back a little bit. Terry says that she started her list in May and is now on 121 birds. Oh, there they are up on the top of the tree now. See them just there too. Oh, they're flying again. They never sit still for too long. So that is fantastic news, Terry, and I hope you keep adding birds to that list and keep it growing. It seems like those babblers have gone out of sight now, unfortunately. Let's carry on up ahead. We're going to carry on with our bumble, and hopefully we get to have one last little sneak peek of these lions before we have to end the show. So I'm still just making my way closer just in case they call me right in at the last second. I know you'll all appreciate even just to have one last glimpse at some lions. Right, Jamie's reached her destination at Buffalo's Hook Dam, and I'm going to continue making my way towards those lions.
We have reached our destination. In this case, it is Buffalo's Hook Dam, and what an incredibly dramatic change we have here. Absolutely, there was more rain on the northern side of Juma than there was in the south. This is quite incredible. When you think about what a vast surface area Buffalo's Hook Dam has, you can imagine how much rain. When you think of how incredibly dry that mud was, so how much of it was soaked up by the mud first before it started to gather, and you get an idea of how much rain we had. Isn't that wonderful? Another big rain like that and we won't even be able to see the mud at the bottom of Buffles Hook Dam. This is Buffles Hook Major, there's Buffles Hook Minor at the back, because there's a strange little ridge between them. I don't quite understand. But there you go, Buffles Hook Major and Minor have water in them once again. The hippos don't have to fight so much for space anymore. The animals have somewhere to drink that's going to become nice and clean. It is marvellous. Of course, I've trapped myself now, haven't I? Because I can't drive across the dam wall. By the way, there are no terrapins yet. They will be by the sunset safari, though, I have a feeling. And we're going to go all the way around Buffles Hook East. It was unbelievably pleasant last night, sitting and listening to the sound of the thunderstorm and the rain pouring on the roof. Listening to these Franklin, I'm going to try and find them. They're making a lot of noise, and then I'm going to look up in my bird book what it is exactly the bird book says they say. Look at this poor bateleur, attempting to balance itself in this wind. Well done. Sorry, Dave. Awkward angle. There we go. There she is. Without a tail, bateleur battling the high winds. Must be quite fun. I think it must be quite fun. Look at it go. Look at her go. Sorry, it was a female. Let's go a little bit further around the corner and then we can answer Marisha's question when she was wondering what they would, Franklins would be described as, or the sound that they make in the book, and saying that they would be described as the bush alarm clock. Absolutely, the kind of alarm clock that you can't set the time for. So 4 o'clock in the morning is perfect for them, which is all right for us, I suppose. We're up then anyway. Certainly in summer we are. But when it's your morning off, that's not so bad anyway, because your body clock wakes you up. Okay, one last look. What are we doing? Crested Franklin. Let's have a look at what the book says for Crested Franklin. We all know what they sound like. Most of us know what they sound like. Franklin Crested. 124. Goodness. Okay, our Crested Franklin is described as a rattling duet. Chee-chuckler, chee-chuckler. Actually, that's not so bad. Chee-chuckler, 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 chee-chuckler. Yep, fair enough. Okay, that's a good one. Okay, that one gets the nod. That was pretty descriptive. I think you might... My point about this whole exercise was if you were reading this book without ever hearing the bird call, or if you were trying to figure out if the bird that you're looking at is the one in the book, you'd struggle to do it with the call. You'd struggle to equate what's written with the call. Not that that's anybody's fault. Alright, well, the birds are out and about and going about their daily meals. Let's go and see some ox pickers with some impala.
Well, we did have ox pickers. Oh, there we go. Look at the ox pickers. They are giving the impala gears this morning. So every ox picker that has landed on the impala have made a concerted effort to chase them off. You can see that there. So there's another one. Hello. And they are both fluffy. The impala, as well as that ox pecker, has its feathers all ruffled. And it is really cold. I think it's even colder than when we started first thing this morning. Look at them just sitting there. So those impala have sat down now, just trying to keep out of the wind. Obviously, the lower down to the ground you are, the better. But they're probably a lot warmer than we are. And I'm sure Jamie's told you about the phylo erection. But just to sort of simplify it, it's basically like an electric blanket that is formed between the layer of the skin and the fatty layer on the impala. So it's a nice warm air pocket, and I wish right now I had that adaption. It would have been really great, because I am sitting here and I am frozen solid, but serves me right for wearing shorts Now look at this oxpecker, just trying to get, there we go. No, don't go to the eyes. But I see what this oxpecker is doing. It's trying to get into spots underneath sort of the face, where also possibly there'll be a lot of ticks that congregate in that area. And like humans, I'm pretty sure the animals like to eat on these nice cold days. Sort of comforting, isn't it? I'm hoping that we're going to have jungle oats or something along those lines for breakfast this morning, because I think that would honestly do the trick and warm us all up so nicely. But you can also see this impala is now taking the opportunity to ruminate. Normally they'll ruminate during the heat of the day, but I suppose when it's nice and cold as well and you don't want to be up and walking around, they're going to just sit and catch up on some digesting. And that oxpecker, they are so funny. They always feel like they're looking straight at you. That oxpecker knows to keep its distance. Oh no, now I'm going to sit on in the middle of your head and clean the ticks out over there. Now there are two different species of oxpecker. I don't know if I've told any of you this before. Any of you this? So these are the red-billed oxpeckers, and then you'll occasionally see in this area the yellow-billed oxpeckers, which is a very special one to see. And you'll find them at the end of a big buffalo herd. So if you have a breeding herd of buffalo that are more than about 200, then you've got a really good chance of seeing the yellow-billed oxpecker. And their call is slightly different as well. It's a lot deeper and a lot more raspy than the red-billed oxpecker, so that's something to listen out for. Now, because most people would think that they're competing for the same food source, and you're correct. However, the yellow-billed oxpeckers tend to go for the bigger, juicier ticks that you'll find on the animals, whereas these red-billed oxpeckers have almost got that comb-like structures inside their beaks, and you'll normally see them scissoring through the hair of the animal. So this one seems to just really be pecking, and they're eating the finer ticks. You see that there? How it sort of runs its beak through the hair, and then it picks up all the little ticks and other little parasites that are in there. Oh, get off my face, please. Oxpecker doesn't take no for an answer. They are very persistent. But do you see what I say when I say that it looks like they keep looking at us? They peck, 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 and then they stare straight towards us with that bright yellow eye. Isn't that a beautiful shot? An impala and an oxpecker happily going about their day. Well, the impala seems to get a little bit frustrated with this oxpecker every now and then. Here we go. You can see that motion that I was talking about as it sort of scissors through the hair. These are also quite comical birds, the oxpeckers, especially when they're in groups and they have little domestic disputes. I believe that Jamie is having a lot of fun this morning. Remember how I was telling you that our rain covers were trying to make an escape? I think hers managed to take off with the wind, which is quite funny. That's the entertainment that comes with the wind and the rain, is we have to try and protect all this equipment that makes it possible for you out there to watch the show live. Good morning, Kelvin. Kelvin wants to know why impalas, when walking, have their tails down most of the time. Now, impala normally have their tails sort of tucked between their legs, and sometimes you see it's closer, being held closer towards their bum, like it is at the moment. And we can't really see it too much now because obviously these impalas are sitting down. I think it's keeping their bums nice and warm. Now, if you get an animal like, or another antelope, for instance, like Nyala, who have a nice white streak under their tail. See that? See, even when they run, they're still keeping it flat on their bums. Now, with Inyala and Kudu and Bushbuck, when they are running, they actually flip their tails up and show that white fluffy hair, which acts as a follow me sound, which we were talking about earlier. So it just depends. It's the same thing in Nyala, Kudu. When they're walking normally, their tails stay flat. There's no need for them to curl it up and expose that white hair. But now Impala have different follow me signs. You can see those three black lines on the rump. and they have no need to turn their tails up. They've got those markings exposed all the time. You can see them just as this one disappears off into the distance. I think that male has had enough of that ox pecking. See a little female coming through. She's also ruminating. There's an entire group of them that have all just decided to sit around here, and I think they're probably going to spend most of the morning just relaxing, trying to keep as warm as possible. Quite amazing how that green guari bush just stands out. Let's try have one last little look, everybody, before we end the show. And I unfortunately don't think that we are going to be able to get to these lions this morning. I think there's just too much excitement around it, and we were lucky enough just to be able to find them this morning. I think, can you see a few more impala in there? Let's have one last look. Yeah, they're all hiding away, as you can see. Well, everybody, unfortunately, our time is almost up now for the show. We'll probably try and follow up on the lions. Hopefully Jamie's keen to see some of the lions, some more of the lions, seeing as she just had a little glimpse this morning. But it has been wonderful to again spend another amazing sunrise safari, though it wasn't quite a sunrise. So just from myself and from Eggsy, who's hiding behind the camera, it was lovely, and I hope to see you again this afternoon. Let's have a little look at the impala just before we go.